Yes, we are called upon to be Christ-like, and Christ forgave us, and therefore we are called unto forgiveness. Many stories and maybe movies we've watched, most times as they are coming to the end, most stories have this theme of forgiveness, where the antagonists, those who are bad before, they come and ask the ones they had offended to forgive them. And these stories captivate us. And then we think, could our lives be as simple as they portray them to be? And I'm sure most of us would say no, because at times we even fail to forgive our friends when they lose our things. For the very small offenses, we are unable to forgive. And Christ has commanded us to forgive. And the practice of forgiveness becomes so hard. We are quick to say, let's forgive one another. At times when you're in those circles, in your accountability circle, when you tell people, you share, you're told to share, you share of forgiveness, and you tell them, let's forgive one another as Christ has forgiven us. It's so easy to say, but it's always very difficult to do. And Christ is not calling us to say or to proclaim we are forgiving people. He's calling us to do that, to forgive. And once, C.S. Lewis once said that, and I quote, "We all agree that forgiveness is a beautiful idea until we have to practice it." You know, forgiveness is that idea that, yes, I can. If someone would hurt me, I would be quick to forgive. As she was saying here, the one who was acting, that the uncle raped her. Is it so easy to forgive them? It becomes a great idea to forgive, but really very difficult to do. And so I want us first to think on these very short facts about forgiveness that I found. Just 5 facts, I'm sure there are many, before we get into God's model of forgiveness and our response to forgiveness. And one, I think of forgiveness as a package, you know, a gift box. When someone brings you a gift, maybe a phone like this, and they've wrapped it so well with a ribbon, a very beautiful ribbon, and they bring it to you, and before you even, obviously they have not brought an empty box, it has something inside. So think of forgiveness as that gift box that has been wrapped. It has things inside, and those things, it entails the offense that people have done, maybe someone has done, that act that has made you so angry with them and you hold them in your heart. And the other thing, it also has the offender. You may be the offender, the one who has wronged, or you may be the offended, the one who has offended someone else. And when you are unwrapping that gift box, and the gift box is forgiveness itself. When you unwrap forgiveness, all the things that were inside, they disappear. Because once you forgive someone, you're supposed to forget. And no longer does the offense hold, no longer does the offender hold, no longer does the offended hold. Think forgiveness also as a binding thing. Forgiveness is binding. It has its consequences. Once you tell someone you have forgiven them, it's sure you have forgiven them. And the consequence is for you to forget, not to keep on bringing it and telling them, you know, you did this, I forgave you, but you're doing it again. Once you have told someone you have forgiven them, it's sure you have forgiven them. And you have to live by the consequences. It is easier to forgive the repentant than the unrepentant. Most times, when someone is very remorseful, as Gertrude was very remorseful and asking for forgiveness, it's easier to forgive them that have understood, and yewe, I have hurt you, and I'm coming and I'm pleading for forgiveness. It's easier to forgive them, and very difficult to forgive the ones that are very ignorant and do not even care when they hurt you along the way. The fourth fact is that forgiveness doesn't come naturally. It never comes naturally. And also the fifth one, forgiveness is a process. And the other one I've come to learn as they were doing it here, forgiveness is not just a feeling. You don't just wake up this morning and you say, I think my heart, I feel I can forgive you, and so you forgive. And then tomorrow, when it comes again, full force, again you have not forgiven them. You realize you have not forgiven them. So forgiveness is not just a feeling, it's a decision that you make. It's a process, and you have to go through the process. So let's get into the Word of God and think through God's grace as the model of forgiveness. Yes, think through God's grace as the model of forgiveness. Let's read from the book of Romans, verse 9 to 20. And it says, I'm reading from the NIV version. What shall we conclude then? Do we have any advantage? Not at all, for we have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throats are open graves. Their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways, and the way of peace they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. Rather, through the law, we may become conscious of our sin. And this is Paul who was speaking, and most times we're in that category. We, mere beings, are very depraved and we're so far away from God. And we have sinned against this very righteous and holy God. And when we come to Him and ask Him for forgiveness, He forgives us regardless. I was thinking about how great God is and how marvelous He is and how even creation bows before Him. In Psalms 19, it says, even the skies proclaim the goodness of God. Let's look at Psalms 19, verse 1. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the works of His hands. Look at this holy God, look at this great and awesome God. Even His own creation, the things that don't talk, we don't hear mountains proclaiming or skies even saying, God, you're great. We are the ones who have the ability to even tell God that you're great. But in all these marvels of the earth, they proclaim the good works of God. And us who are human beings, who are able to relate to this God, we have failed Him terribly. We have failed Him terribly. And He says that He forgives us. And He remembers our sins no more. Look at the life of Christ and how He left His throne. He did not count His equal. He was still God, and He did not look at that as something to be taken for as advantage. But He came, left the throne, and came to die for you, came to die for me. I had wronged Him terribly, and we were never remorseful, yet He forgave us. Think about the life of Christ just before crucifixion. And I'm sure all these thoughts were going on in Christ's mind, that these people do not know I am going to die for them. These people do not know I have come to die, to be mocked for their sake, so that they be reconciled back to God. And I was looking at the life of Christ just before crucifixion, as Christ already knew that His disciples would desert Him when trouble would come, as many would run and hide out of fear of being killed with Jesus. He knew, and I was thinking, if I was in that era, and Christ here was saying, you know, you guys will run away from me, And he also told Peter that, Peter, you would deny me 3 times before the cock crows in the morning. And you, as Peter, would say, no, I would not. I love you, Christ. You know I love you. And then he knew that the people, the ones that he went feeding, the 5,000, imagine Christ feeding the 5,000, he healed all their diseases. He did all these good things for them. And yet he knew that when the moment would come, they would chant the name of Jesus, crucify him. And when Pilate would ask, would you want me to release Jesus or to release Barnabas, a city murderer? They would say, crucify Jesus. And Jesus knew, yet he went to the cross, and his focus was not on how people were reacting towards him. He had a mission he had to complete. He had to forgive all of us. When you look at all these events that Christ was going through just before his death on the cross, you would think that they would demoralize Christ. And Christ would say, Lord, I'm not going to forgive them. Look, they are killing me right now. They are mocking me. They are saying, if I'm the Savior, let me save myself. But Christ knew, and his focus and willingness was on securing each and every one of us our own forgiveness. So Christ has set that high bar for us to follow. A very high bar that it calls for each and every one of us to be very deliberate, to forgive one another, not to hold anyone in our hearts. For Christ never held us accountable. He went to the cross and said, it is finished. It is finished. And so I have read a few verses, and we'll see the characteristics of God's forgiveness. And one is that God initiates the process. He initiates the process of forgiveness. Let's read from the book of Romans, chapter 5. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8. And it says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And in 1 John 4:19 it says, we love because he first loved us. Christ first did it. He did not wait for us to be remorseful. He did not wait for us to see the extent of our depravedness, the extent of the things that we had done wrong, for him to come and willingly die on the cross. He initiated the process. Then we who call ourselves Christians, yes, we call ourselves Christ's followers. When somebody does something to you, very hurtful, maybe it's grave, maybe they're responsible for even changing even the outcome of your life, but we wait for them to be remorseful, and that's when we say, now God, I will forgive them. Would you forgive them even if they will not come to you to ask for it? I pray that you would follow the example of Christ. And other times when we offend others and our pride and ego becomes too precious to bruise or to crease, and we fail to even ask for forgiveness, we say, anyway, God said he'll forgive those who forgive others. I mean, I'm not supposed to forgive because I'm the one who has offended them. And then you tell yourself, in fact, they will be the ones accountable to God. But do you ever take the first step to even ask for forgiveness when you're wrong? And the second characteristic is that God freely forgives. God forgives freely. And we'll read again from Romans chapter 8 and verse 32, part A of that verse, and it says, it reveals how God freely gave us his son. It says, he did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us. You know, he did not spare him and say, just people let them do, or let them come up with the remedy for their sin, and Christ will still sit on the throne and not come down. But God freely gave us Jesus. To God, it costed him everything. Giving up his own son, Christ was still God, fully God. And God sent his own begotten son, beloved son, that all of us would come back to God. He gave him up freely. The forgiveness that we received from God, it costed God his son, and yet it costed us nothing. We did not let a pesa and say, God, we have gathered up these trillions of money, and so we are coming to say that now you may release Jesus to die for us. We never did anything of that sort. And Christ came regardless. We didn't pay for it, yet we really have received this grace of salvation. So indeed, we are to freely give it. At times, we tend to look at ourselves, and when someone has really grieved you, and they ask you, what should I do for you to forgive me? You tell them, buy me a gift. And you wait for the gift in order that you may forgive them. That is not Christ-likeness. So we are to freely forgive as God has freely forgiven us. Another thing is that he forgives fully. God forgives fully. In Isaiah chapter 1, and verse 18, says, come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. Here God is not saying, I will forgive you, but you know, I'll not cleanse you, the whole of you. I'll still remain some sins in you, so that I can hold leverage against you. But God cleanses everything. He forgave us everything, even the things that we've yet done to him. He has already forgiven us. He forgives us fully. And his forgiveness is for us to be pure. He gives us a clean slate for us to start again, living as Christ instructs us to live. And how this book really explains the kind of situation we are in. And we could start, first of all, in Micah chapter 2, and verse 1 to 2, and see the state that these people were in the time of Micah. Yes, Micah chapter 2. Yes, chapter 2 and verse 1. And he says, woe to those who plan iniquity, to those who plot evil on their beds. At morning's light, they carry it out because it is in their power to do it. They covet fields and seize them, and houses and take them. They defraud people of their homes. They rob them of their inheritance. This is how the Israelites were in this time. The leaders were so corrupt. The judges would literally ask for bribes in order to help other people. People would kill each other. And these people, when you look and you say, how, Lord, could you forgive them? But God, as you read through the book of Micah, and you find that God has promised. He has promised to forgive them, the remnant of Israel. These people who in God's eyes, and even God had already, he had already judged them. And this time he's saying, I have forgiven you, remnants of Israel, remnants of my inheritance. In chapter 7, verse 18 to 20, it says, who is a God like you? This is Micah now saying and telling God, who is a God like you, who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea. You will be faithful to Jacob and show love to Abraham as you pledged and on oath to our ancestors in the days long ago. And this is God. Even Micah is amazed. It's you, God, saying that you will not retain your anger against us. Who are we when we wait for others to do something good in order for us to repay them with forgiveness if they wrong us? And as you continue, you realize that God, his original idea and his original plan is to return us back to him. Even after pressing judgment upon us, he has forgiven us. And finally, he forgives eternally. God does not bring up each and every time our sins to us. His forgiveness is sure. In Psalms 103, I love this Psalm 103 that says, verse 9 to 12, it says, he will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. He will not accuse us, nor will he harbor anger. He does not treat us as our sins deserve. We deserved eternal condemnation. Yet he repaid us, and he did not think and did not allow us to be condemned eternally. He has not repaid our sin with death. Rather, he exchanged it with Christ, and we became alive again. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is God's love for us who fear him. As far as east is from the west, so far has God separated us from our sin. And I would think, at times you stand maybe on an open ground and you try to think, if maybe this is my east, the farthest you can see is your east, and the farthest you can see on this other side is your west. And it seems so far, yet we know just a glimpse of even the distance. We do not know even the extent of this whole universe. And yet God tells us that as far as east is from the west, in God's eyes, not in our own, as far as that east is from the west, so far has he separated us from our sin. And Isaiah 43 and verse 25 says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers them no more. He does not remind us that, oh, you used to fornicate and now you've come to Christ, and when you pray to him, he still reminds you. No, God does not do that. And yet we who call ourselves Christians, most of us are, we keep reminding others of how they have ruined our lives, and we do not forget, we do not remember of how Christ did it for us. And so it is a high bar that is set for all of us. If we are to be like Christ, then it will cost us to forgive. We will have to go an extra mile to forgive. And so what are the implications of God's model of forgiveness, or what is our response rather to God's forgiveness? And one is self-forgiveness. And we would ask ourselves, is self-forgiveness a biblical concept? Is there anywhere in the Bible that has been said of God, I wrote it for us to read, that now, see, you may forgive yourself for the things that you've done against yourself. Nowhere the Bible has told us to forgive ourselves. But in the whole story of forgiveness and how we came to receive it, we can get that we are also to forgive ourselves. And failure to forgive ourselves of past sins and atrocities after coming to Jesus is a disregard, a total disregard of what Christ already did for us. If indeed Christ cleansed everything, who are you to still hold on to the things that you did and say, Lord, I blame myself for this, and Christ already has forgiven you? Why dwell? Why continue dwelling on what you already did and Christ has already cleansed? And I want us to have this illustration. But let us to close our eyes for a moment. Let's close our eyes for a moment. And think of this child, of a boy, a son, who is very loved by the parents. And this boy, one time, does a very good thing, and the parents are so joyous. And they say that today, you know, they come to him and surprise him that we fully paid for a trip, for a trip that you go to Disney World for Christmas. It's a gift that the parents have said. Think of that boy and the joy the boy has. It's almost as if it's unreal. Open your eyes. I'm sure you've seen that boy and the joy in his heart. And the joy in his heart when he even imagines what a trip to Disney World, all the fun. And then this boy tells the parents, Mom or Dad, I am not going. And shock on the parents, and the child refuses to go just because he does not believe it's real. And you're like, wow, if someone would come here and tell me, Esther, we'll go to maybe Australia or Paris. And because I do not believe them, I say to them, I do not want to go. Yet, a ticket is here. It has already been written, Esther Wigan, visa, you're going to Australia. And I say, I'm not going because I do not still believe that it is real. And that is how we are when we fail to forgive ourselves. It seems unreal that, oh Christ, you have forgiven me. It seems unreal, and we still hold ourselves guilty. Romans 8, verse 1. Verse 1 to 4. It says, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Imagine it. That there is no other condemnation to us who are in Christ Jesus. Christ has set us free from the law of sin and even death. For the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh. It was weakened by the flesh. God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. If indeed by Christ being the sin offering for us, and he says that he condemns sin in the flesh through Christ, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, then what are you still holding against yourself? Why are you still condemning yourself for the things that you have done and already Christ has forgiven you? And so by this we nullify what Christ did on the cross. And we say that Christ, yes, you did die, but still you are not able to forgive even these things that I still continue to do. And these things that trouble us, torment us, could be a recurrent sin that keeps on coming and coming, and you're asking God for forgiveness each and every time, and you still go back to do it, and you do it again and again. And every time you want to stop, it keeps on coming back. It is a sort of torment. And you call on God for forgiveness, but can't keep forgive yourself, as you feel as though you're betraying God every time. You tell God to help you overcome. No sooner than you finish, then you start doing it all over again. It could be a secret sin that you keep on doing when you're alone, and you come here and you praise the very beautiful songs and you go to heaven and you ask God to forgive you, and immediately after you leave that door and you open your phone, you're back again to the same scene. And we ask ourselves, is the grace of God sufficient to cleanse even those recurrent sins? It is. It is time to let God fully be in control of your life. He has forgiven you, so let go of everything that still you still hold on to and blame yourself for it. So let it pass and begin a new life with a deeper conviction that Christ will help you stand. And in fact, if you continue to dwell in the Word of God and pray to Him, He is very faithful to keep you out of those recurrent sins. Be honest with yourself. List all the things that you hate about your past, the things that keep tormenting you, the things that you did and they are still coming back to you. List them one by one and give them to the Lord. Those burdens that you still hold in your heart, give them to Christ. And you realize that your debt has already been paid. For indeed, there is no sin that Christ hasn't pardoned. He cleanses all unrighteousness. Allow God to heal your soul. This is a process that you have to do if indeed self-forgiveness is something that troubles you and you're not able to do. Allow God to heal your soul. Open your heart and allow the light of Christ to shine into the darkness of your soul. Christ cares for all of us. Even if we are millions and millions, He still cares for your soul. And so allow Him, allow His light, which is found in His Word, to speak to your life. And His light will surely drive out all darkness in your soul. Begin to see yourself as a new creature or a new creation in the Lord. For behold, the old is gone, the new has come. And the second implication of this forgiveness of God is forgiving others. This is where most of us are, we fail to forgive others. And I'm in the mood of telling stories, and I'll tell you of a story. I hear it's a Spanish story, but it could relate to all of us too. There was once a father and a son. Let's call the son Furaha. Let's call him Furaha. And so this father and son never saw eye to eye. They had become estranged. They were so indifferent. And one day this son says, enough is enough. I cannot speak to my dad again. He packs all his bags and leaves home. And his father, because of the love that he has for his son, he sets out to find his son. He goes, looks for him everywhere. He hears, we have seen this kind of person. He goes to check if it's the son. He finds, oh, it's not him. And so he looks for him for months and months without success. And finally, in desperation, the father decides, anyway, I work in a company, in a newspaper company. See, I can print, or I can put an ad to tell my son to come back home. Probably he'll read the newspaper and he'll come back home. And so the father decides and goes on to the newspaper farm and writes this, or yeah, he puts this ad in the paper that day. That, dear Furaha, meet me in front of this newspaper office at noon on Saturday. Let's say that Saturday will be 13. Yes, meet me on 13th at noon, just outside this newspaper office. All is forgiven. I love you. And he writes your father, end of quote. Just a small ad that he puts. What do you think happens that Saturday? That Saturday, a few minutes to noon, the newspaper office just right outside, it is full of people. Anyone who's called Furaha is just outside the door. And everyone is looking for forgiveness from their supposed father. So this goes on to say that many people are hurt. Every one of us is in search for forgiveness. And probably if it would be an Esther, I'm just saying, I would be there knowing that my father will forgive me. He has already said he has forgiven me, so I'm coming back home. So most of us would be there. Indeed, we are in a fallen world. And forgiveness is essential for us to maintain relationships. And in commission, I remember a certain speaker was saying, Godly success, it's not measured by the monetary value that we have, but godly success is measured in the investment of relationships. And these relationships are breaking every time, simply because we do not have the heart to forgive what has been done against us. And this forgiveness, it seems easy when somebody would come and accidentally cut you with a knife. After the wound has healed, it will be very easy for you to forgive them because the wound has already healed. So you hold nothing against them. But when the heart goes deeper, when the heart is in your emotional life, then it becomes so hard to forgive. Why is it that on our emotional levels of life, it becomes difficult to let people go? And the deeper the heart goes, I'm speaking about the heart of H-U-R-T, the deeper the heart, the more difficult it is to forgive. And for us as Christians, when you read the book of Matthew chapter 6 and verse 15, yes, Matthew 6, in verse 15, and say, or let's begin on the from 14. This was the time Christ was teaching his disciples. We could even start from verse 9, and it says, "This then is how you should pray: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your heavenly Father will not forgive your sins. And for us as Christians, we read that portion of scripture. It dawns on us that forgiveness is not optional. Because all of us are in dire need of God's forgiveness. Because even after we listen to the sermon today, it will still be difficult to forgive. And here we're being told if we fail to forgive, then our Father also will not forgive us. So it ceases to become optional for us. It's a must that we should forgive. Because indeed no one wants to miss out on the forgiveness of the Father. And then we ask ourselves, then why should we forgive? Why should we allow ourselves to go through that hurt and say, I know you've done so much to grieve me, but we are good. All is forgiven. Why then should we forgive? From that verse in Matthew, from verse 14, we forgive in order that the Father may forgive us also. It may seem very selfish that we forgive just because we want God to forgive us, but it's very real. No one wants to miss out on the forgiveness of God. No one wants to face the full wrath of God. And so what is that thing, that very small thing that would make the Lord not forgive you? So let's forgive one another. Another one is that we forgive so that Satan will not take advantage of us. This is a very soft spot where the devil's schemes can be used against us. And in 2 Corinthians, we find this in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 10. And it says, anyone you forgive, I also forgive. And what I have forgiven, if there was anything to forgive, I have forgiven in the sight of Christ for your sake. Indeed, Lord, and the Lord has forgiven us. In order that Satan might not outwit us. In other versions, it says, in order that Satan might not take advantage of us. For we are not aware of his schemes. And so this is very crucial. The other time we were being spoken about the battle within and how within us is the flesh and the spirit and they are in constant conflict. And the devil knows very well, he's very scheming, he knows where to get us. And one of the areas that you can really take advantage of us is on this, of forgiving each other, forgiving one another, loving one another. The other time we were being spoken about authentic love. How do we show that we love one another? It is by forgiving one another. And then the other thing that forms the base of us forgiving others is that we may maintain peace and unity in the body of Christ. Because at times, even in church, people hold grudges in church. And we think that people outside there, ndio watu wanakuwa na grudges, but we also have people in church who hold grudges. And here in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, as Paul was writing, and this is God speaking to us through Apostle Paul, says that we forgive in order that we may maintain peace and unity in the body of Christ in Ephesians. chapter 4, in verse 1 to 3. And it says, as a prisoner of the Lord, then, this is Paul saying, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing one another in love. Make every effort to keep the peace of the Spirit through the bond of verse 3 says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you are called to one hope when you are called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, one Father of all, who is over all and through all in all. Indeed, all of us have been called from one faith. We all are united in one faith. We all are united in one baptism. We all are called from one Father, who is Lord over all of us. Indeed, how do we show that we are living according to the call that God has called us to? He tells us in verse 2, be completely humble and gentle. Then forgiving people are never humble. They are never gentle. So we've been called to humility and gentleness. Be patient, bearing one another in love. This is where you tolerate each other in love. You do not hold things against them. Because we all know we have been called unto this salvation, all of us, from one God, in one Lord, in one faith, in one baptism. And so let us stop having grudges in church. Because someone has hurt you, at times it's in relationships, and we fail to let go. And we are still in church, and when you see the other person, you cannot even speak to them. Let's be humble and gentle and patient with one another, bearing with one another in love. And we should make every effort to keep the unity in the body of Christ. And I'm coming to the conclusion of today's message. And I want us to think about this, to understand the following. When we set to forgive others, that the motive should be to glorify God alone, for He has forgiven us. The motive should be to glorify God. I do not forgive you for you to see, oh, I am very humble, I am very patient with people. No, it's for the name of God to be glorified. Therefore, forgive one another and bearing with one another in love. The second one is that remember how much God has forgiven you in Christ. It should form the anchor, or it should be something that you live for. I'll forgive because God has forgiven me. Think of how much He has and still is doing in your life. And it's so small an offense when you fail to forgive the other person. And number 3, have compassion on the other person as a fellow sinner needing God's grace. We are all sinners. And so let's have compassion and love for each other. For indeed we are all in dire need of God's grace in our lives. And lastly, be kind, be tender-hearted, and ready to always grant forgiveness. It should not be just granting forgiveness, but also seeking forgiveness. As we had read earlier, we should be initiators of the process of forgiveness. So we should seek for forgiveness whenever we have wronged, and we should also grant it when people have wronged us. And so in conclusion, we are all in different relationships. Probably sister-brother relationship, parent-child relationship, friend relationship amongst ourselves. And every now and then we are called to ask and grant forgiveness. And so we should not procrastinate. I hope I've said it right. Yes, we should not procrastinate forgiveness. Let's forgive one another. Let's continue showing people that yes, we are Christ's followers because we know the extent of God's forgiveness in our lives. Let's show kindness to one another and be ready to always restore relationships.